to today's broadcast.
We started with Psalms 119 last week, and so let's start with 119 again. And again, in your own time, read through the entire 119, and basically we could sum it up as word thirst. If you read through Psalm 119, I know it's 170-something verses, but, you know, break it down piece by piece by piece by piece. It actually was a part of, I think I had like 15 to 20 chapters of Psalms I had to read, and 119 happened to be within all that other reading, but it's good reading. All right, so blessed are the undefiled in the way who walk in the law of the Lord. So key word, underline, highlight is law. Blessed are they that keep his testimonies, highlight testimonies, and seek him with the whole heart. They also do iniquity, they walk in his ways, highlight ways. Thou hast commanded us to keep thy precepts diligently, highlight precepts, keep thy precepts diligently. Oh, that my ways were directed to keep thy statutes, highlight statutes. Then shall I be ashamed when I have respect unto all thy commandments, highlight commandments. I will praise thee with upright heart, and when I shall have learned thy righteous judgments, highlight judgments. I will keep thy statutes, forsake me utterly. And then we read on through 16 last time, which ended with, I will delight myself in thy statutes. I will not forget thy word. Verse 11 says, thy word have I hid in mine heart that I might not sin against thee. So it's a very challenging to live this life, to try to live a life right with God, because we're born in sin and shaped in iniquity. And so we don't want to sin against God. Sin is separate. We don't want to do anything that will separate us from God. In his presence is fullness of joy, his right hand pleasures forevermore. Psalm 16 and 11. So here, David said, I found a key to keep me in God's presence, hiding his word in my heart. So making sure his word has filled me up to a point of saturation. So when the demand is placed on me, it places a demand on that word in me. So he walked through some things, and we're going to walk through it since this is a, we're going to take time to break down this word for a while. So he talked about walking in the law. So the law here, again, these are different descriptions of the word. The law here is an authoritative rule or conduct, or a fixed principle. So when you think about a law as a fixed principle, gravity is a law. It's a fixed principle. We're sitting, y'all sitting in them chairs, I'm standing here because of gravity, right? Fixed principle. So no matter, if we're neutral, we're subject to gravity, right? We have to do some things to rise above gravity, called the law of lift or aerodynamics or however you want to do it. And it's the same thing. If you do nothing, you're subject to, let's go to Romans 7. Wasn't planning on hitting this, but let's go to Romans 7. And you'll see how here he talks about a couple of laws or fixed principles here in Romans 7. Look, verse 14, it says, For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. It says, For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that I do not, but what I hate, that I do. So I find myself doing the things that I don't want to do, is what he's saying. He says, if then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good. I consent unto the fixed principle that's already in the earth that it's okay. It says, now then, it is no more that I do it, look, but sin that dwelleth in me. It says, if I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing, for to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I find not. It says, for the good that I would do, not the good that I would, the good that I would, I do not, but the evil which I would not, that I do. He says, now if I do that I would not, so if I'm doing that, which I really normally wouldn't do, it is no more that I do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. I find then a law. Here we go. A fixed principle. It says that when I would do good, evil is present with me. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man. Remember, I hide the word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Psalms 119:11. Right? He says, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind, bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. So there's a law of God, which we're talking about, which is his word. So when I lock my mind or my soul into his word, feed myself with the word, it renews my mind, and my habit is God's word. That word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. When I don't feed myself the word, or just for understanding's sake, when I don't feed myself aerodynamics or the law of lift, I find myself subject to gravity. But when I feed myself the aerodynamics and the law of lift, I find myself flying above gravity, right? When I don't feed myself the word, I find myself subject to sin, separate myself from God. When I feed myself the word, I find myself in harmony with God and his will and in his presence all the time. So if I take the word as optional, I may or I may not eat it, then I may or may not be in the presence of God. I'm risking being in the presence of God. And when I would do good, the scripture says evil is present, looking for an opportunity to pull me out of the presence of God. Or as the scripture says in Peter, Satan is seeking whom he may devour. Who don't have any word in them? Well, I can gain access, right? Or who's leaking the word? So you said Mark chapter 4, it says Satan comes and tries to steal the word immediately, the sower soweth the word. He says, and then some get the word, but he tries to get them offended. So when persecution and affliction arise, it didn't even say for you. It says when persecution and affliction arise for the word's sake, the person is offended. It says, but then some receive the word on stony ground, right? It says, and then some receive the word, they get the word, it gets in them. So you got the people that, they're casual with the word, not really in the word, and so they heard something at church and they walk right out and they take it right away. Then you got some people that got the word, but as soon as something offended them, you know, they got a phone call as soon as they got out, or this week somebody start talking crazy, illogical. So they're trying to take the word. Again, it's trying to, because see, that word is going to change your life, and the adversary knows that. Then there's some that gets the word and gets in, so they're overconfident. Oh, yeah, I got the word. You don't know that scripture? I know that scripture. It says, but they allow the cares of the world, the deceitfulness of riches, and the lust of other things to enter in and choke the word, and it becometh unfruitful. It's not about I know the word. It's not about I read the word. It's about the word producing fruit. So the measure is the fruit, not just what you know. You know, not just casually I read a couple scriptures. What fruit is it producing? So the adversary is like, oh, yeah, you got the word, cool. Long as you allow me in to, so I can choke that word. So when you walk around and you're not bearing the fruit of his word, is because you're allowing out the cares of the world, deceitfulness of riches, the lust of other things. See, you have this philosophy that it's okay to take in the things of the world. What's the big deal? Ain't no big deal. All it's doing is choking the word that I'm getting. All it's doing is stopping me from producing and manifesting the things that's going to fulfill me in my life. I don't see what the big deal is. Why do I have to be fulfilled? I'm existing. I might not be producing no fruit. You know, there's a hot day outside, you see a tree and it has no fruit on it, we call that dead. It's existing, but it's not producing the fruit that God designed for it to produce. That's why he cursed the fig tree. He says, well, if you're not going to produce fruit, why are you here? So we're living a life it ain't based on fruit bearing sometimes. It's based on I'm existing. Well, you know, how you doing today? Well, you know, I'm just, thank the Lord, I'm not 6 feet under today. So as long as I'm not 6 feet under, that's a good day for me. But if you talk to God, he's like, did you produce fruit today? That's a good day for you. Not that if you existed, everybody existed. Hey, you know, it's a garbage can out there. I see it's been there. Every time we come to church, baby, that garbage can is still there. It's existing. So are we just like the trash can? We just exist. Every chair in here, I notice is here, Minister Sammy, every week. Existing. So we chairs now. That's what we are. We just chair. We like the chairs. We existed. Chairs at church every Sunday. They're at church more than all y'all. Now, since you're trying to line up. I was at church, you know, Wednesday and Sunday, 4 weeks in a row. Chairs beat you out there. Because they were here Tuesday. I came in here Tuesday, we're here. They were here on Thursday. We came to counseling. Baby, I looked in the sanctuary. Guess what? Chairs still up in here. Man, chairs here more than the Dixons. Now, you know that chair is up in here if they hear more than the Dixons. Yeah, sitting at attention. What'd you say? Sitting at attention. Upright. Look, locked in. Look, they locked in together. But it ain't about just being here, is it? Right? We beyond chairs, right, Sister Jackie? We trying to produce something. Okay, all right. So now let's go back to what we was talking about in Psalms 119. So we talked about the law as a fixed principle, right? Then he talked about testimony. So testimonies, it's a witness on behalf of God's will. So this word is it's stating fixed principles, but it's also stating testimonies, right? Testimonies. They overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. It's what you've experienced as a result of this word. That's in the Bible, too. You read through the stories of David and Joseph. You know, I was going through some stuff, and I was like, man, it looks crazy. But I can't give up. Why? Because Psalm 27 says, I would have fainted. I would have given up. Unless I believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Not by and by. When we all get to heaven. No. Wait. I mean, that's nice when we get to heaven. That's good. We can have a good time, but we going to wait to heaven? Misty, we just going to wait to heaven. Like, so we're going to suffer and be happy with suffering, Ryder, because we all going to be, man, we get to heaven, man, we're going to be party. Well, no. It says, I would have fainted unless I believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. That's here now. And the Bible says you shall receive 100-fold now in this time and the time to come. That's what the Bible says. So I'm trying to enjoy some things here now in this time too. Right? Well, you know why? Because I read the testimony. I read the testimony when it looked like Job was going down. Whoa, man, I thought he was done. Boy, I was like, man, that's a shame. Job done lost everything, man. Look, let me keep reading the story. I wonder how that's going to end up. Ended up with double. Just like it says in Isaiah, double for your shame. Isaiah was 61, I believe it is. Double for your shame. 61:7, I believe it is. So that testimony of listening to what happened to Job, look, he had all types of stuff on him. He had all types of sickness and disease and all types of everything. Lost everything that was important. But guess what? When you read the testament, what happened? He win. We win, right? Because of the testimonies, right? So you got testimonies. Then you have, well, I didn't know I was going to get into this, but then you have precepts. It talks about ordains your precepts. And its precepts are specific charges, like things that challenge you to push you. You can do it. Like finish the dunk. See, yes, that's a specific charge. Like, close out that lane. You must protect this house. And in the paint, they know they don't come nowhere near your box. If they come anywhere near your box, guess what? You rub that ball on that backboard. And what they start thinking is, anytime we go in there, Ryder just pins our shot on the box. So we're not going in there no more because writers intimidated. We need to come up with a floater or something, but we ain't going in there because writers protecting the house. Because Pastor Key, Felipe, Kelly, and Kyron has charged him. You must protect this house, right? It's a charge, right? Right, it's challenging you. Then you have statutes, and they're acts or orders. So a lot of our laws that we live out in this life has been enacted by legislature, and they call it statutes. So when you have statutes, they're orders. There's things that are directing you in a particular way or directing you in a particular path, right? Then you have commandments. Commandments are your guides. So they're your rules that are imposed by authority. If you step outside of this line, this gonna happen. If you do this sin, this gonna happen. If you embrace this evil, this may happen, right? So that's your commandments. And then you have judgments, which of course, in a court of law, judgment is a sentence. So it's a sentence for a transgression. So basically it's the harvest for the lifestyle of the seed you sow. If you're living crazy, the judgment that you end up dealing with is the consequence of the choice that you made to sow that seed. You reap what you sow, basically. You can even say, be not weary and well doing. It said, God is not mocked. Whatsoever man soweth, that he shall reap. We can call that a judgment. Because if you sow it, you're going to reap it. And that's amazing. I noticed something, Minister Sammy. People get a harvest for the seed that they sow, and then they get mad at God. And I know God be up there going, well, you sowed that seed, so I figured that's the harvest you wanted. And we something in our mind tells us, I sold this seed, so I sold this corn seed, Felipe, but I'm expecting an apple. And so when the corn pop up, corn, I hate corn. You know, I can't believe this corn popped up. God, why would you allow this corn to pop up in my life? You know, what kind of pun? You know my thoughts and my ways. Why didn't you stop the corn? God's like, well, I figured if you sowed it, that's what you want. You had choice, right? You sowed the seed, that's the harvest you wanted. Oh, because you sat around and felt like you can sow corn seed and get apples, you feel like you're going to get apples. My bad. It ain't about what you're doing. It's about how you feel about what you're doing. That's it, babe. See, y'all need to school me, man. All this time I thought, Sister Jackie, that you reap what you sow. I didn't know you reap what you feel you're going to reap, which may not be in line with what you sow. See, it must be another translation, right? That's what it is. We talked about last week, the interpretation of must be another I must be missing the translated version of the Amplified, the way I feel version. That's what it is. Oh, man. I understand now. All this time, I just thought you read with yourself. Not deep, is it, right? All right, so those are I wanted to give you the breakdown because I promised last week I would do that. So we talked about the gaps in understanding last week, and we talked about that God's thoughts are above our thoughts, his ways are above our ways. So, and we talked about how when that word comes down from heaven, it's like the electric power that's coming from the water. It's so powerful that it can't come directly to our house. We plug into that power, we blow up, right? So it's broken down through wires and transformers and circuit breakers. And then we get to use it. We get to use great power at a broken down level, at a level we can handle it, right? Well, it's the same thing with the word. It's great power in the word. Do you realize when God opened his mouth, stuff shake? It's thunder. Do you realize God opened his mouth and the worlds were created? By the voice of his word. The Bible, let's go to Hebrews 11. Holy Spirit, you keep doing these little audibles, but this is cool because it's what, remember we was talking about, babe? See, it's what I got to yield to what he want to talk about. I know what I want to talk about, but the Holy Spirit is the overriding authority. So as a minister, you may have something you want to talk about. But right now, you know, the pastors are the overriding authority. Well, we do the same thing. Holy Spirit's the overriding authority. We can't just be talking about what we want to talk about. He's the authority, right? We yield to him, right? You would think, right? All right, so let's go to Hebrews 3. Hebrews 11, I'm sorry, I apologize. Verse 3. It says, through faith we understand that the worlds were framed. Look at this. The worlds were framed by what? The word of God? It says, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Everything you see was made from the invisible, the heaven realm. So what's more real is the heaven realm. Because what we see is a manifestation from the heaven realm. The tree is a manifestation from the heaven realm. It was made by things that don't appear. And he says the worlds were framed by the word of God. That's how powerful it is. So what he said is, when it comes down, it's so powerful. If you don't prepare yourself to handle it, it's going to be too deep. It's going to be overwhelming. Now, I try to read the word. I try to read the word. I just don't understand it. It's just too deep. Right? It's deep. So I'm going to leave it alone because it's deep. Right? You know, it's just something in your mind just say, so there's gaps. So God says, I won't play you like that. I'm going to break it down. And I'm going to send you men and women of God to break it down. Right? So you can handle it from where you are. Right? So we talked about that last week. We don't have to get too much into that. And we say he sends men of God. You know, people be sending themselves. That's why you don't understand what they're talking about, because they just sent themselves. The Bible says, except you be sent, not except you send yourselves. You know, so somebody went online, got them a degree, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, they got their own little personal Bible study, you know, or they reading other people's sermons and haven't authenticated the person. And so you don't understand because they weren't sent. They sent themselves. They weren't ordained, set apart by God. Right? So we talked about that. And we talked about the difference between translating and interpretation. So I'm not going to get into that. And we broke down canonization, historical criticism, textual criticism, exegesis, hermeneutics, and biblical theology to understand that there's a process to understand the word. And one, don't let people or don't yourself think that you can excuse yourself from understanding the word because how do I know the Bible's true? It's been handed down for years. King James, I don't know King James. How I know King James didn't change some things? First of all, this is before I even got into understanding canonization and stuff like that. I just used common sense. This was my common sense. Because the Bible says you know God exists by the things he created. That's what the Bible says. So I just used common sense. I looked up in the sky and I saw the sun. God spoke that sun into existence. But he can't protect his word through time? Oh, he used all his power for creation and then ran out of power when it came to protect his word. That's what it is. That same God that put that sun in the sky is the one that tells us, hey, if you're going to live this life, start with my word. Get into my word. And he's protected that word. It's transcended time. And what you don't realize is we as rebellious people come against God, turn our backs on God, decide that we want to sit around a house and do a little something. I just slipped that in there for that reason. You know, I don't know. Maybe that was the Holy Spirit or maybe that was me. But we do that. But the kings that ruled, that didn't even always live, wasn't from Jerusalem, Israel, wasn't about the tribes, but they knew something. The God of Israel is God. God used Nebuchadnezzar. He wasn't even part of the crew. But he knew enough. Listen, whatever God did, Daniel, when Daniel came up out of that lion's den, whatever Daniel's God says, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, whoa, listen, whatever they guys say, that's what we doing. Now, do you think it stopped that day? They handed down this. No, listen, we can do whatever we want, but whatever these people guys say, we ain't coming against God, the God. We can act like we worshiping idols if we want to, but if it's going to come down to God, they have more reverence for God than us that are Christians have had reverence for God. They weren't willing to risk coming against God, and we be taking chances every day. Ain't that amazing? They have that much reverence. So that's why we know the Bible is true. And so we talked about canonization, and that canonization is the only thing put in this Bible is what was inspired by God. God breathed. All scripture is given by the inspiration of God, 2 Timothy 3:16. And then we said, you look at the historical criticism. Remember, we talked about the history, the harmony, and the humility. It says that it's the history is the framework, and then the text is the wording, but it's like, how does this word line up with all the other things in the Bible? Don't just use one scripture and turn it into a doctrine or a religion like people do. How does it line up with the entire Bible, the progressive revelation? The Bible is a progressive revelation from Genesis to Revelations. And so we talked about that, and the hermeneutics is there's rules in how to process the Bible. The Old Testament, when it was converted from Hebrew, is written in a permissive sense. So a lot of times when it said God did, it's really saying God allowed. Because it was, we're Americans, so we speak English. So when you, just like if you turn some Spanish over, you know, how do the verbs and stuff, whether it's trabajar or different things like that, working and things like that. When you start to turn it over, como se llama, how they put the text is different than how we do in English. Now we flip that into what's your name, don't we? We flip it into what time is it? But the way it's broken down is almost like the verb starts out first. You see what I'm saying? So it shouldn't be so hard to believe that when they translated Hebrew, they translated into more of God did versus God allowed. So that's why you have to understand how historically to line things up. Look at what God did. No, look at what God allowed. See, now you're looking at things through different. Well, how are we supposed to know that? Take the time to listen and understand the things that God set before you. Right? Everything else you do that. You guys are master at PlayStation. How you know that? New game just came out. How you know how to take out those guys up in the right flank? Oh, you got all the moves when it comes to NBA Live. How you know that? All this new technology come out. How you know how to use it? Oh, but now when it comes to the Bible, well, it's a trick. It's not a trick. You've been designed to discover. Use what you've been using to discover stuff that doesn't edify you to edify you in the Word. It's real simple. All right, so we talked about the biblical theology, and that's really what the result of all that is. All right, so you want to prepare yourself to be able to interpret or teach the Word. All of us, which, you know, you have a family. The scripture says in, I believe it's Deuteronomy 6, either Deuteronomy 6 or number 6, but it says, teach them when they walk by the way, when they sit down, when they standeth up. Bind that word around their neck. So whatever they're doing, they see the word. See, back in the day, I remember studying this out, with schools up until maybe like 1914, when you got up in the morning, you had devotion. When you went to school, guess what? You had devotion. When you was in school, a part of your classes was just history and stuff like that, math and things of that nature. But guess what? You talked about the word. You had classes on the word. So back then, it wasn't teenage pregnancy and people tripping and rebelling. It wasn't like that because what? People's focus, he'll keep them in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on him. So your mind is going to be stayed on him because you're always in the word. When you sit down, when you walk by the way, you got signs and banners. People got stuff on their refrigerators and their mirrors and something comes up. They're lining it up with the word. So, of course, your flow is through the lenses of the word. You see the difference? So we got to be in a position where we can interpret this word and we can be able to express it. So number one, you have to be married to discipline, or what we call it, the press. There's a press. Remember, you got the press, you got the pleasure, and then you got the passion of the word, or the discipline, the desire, and the delight. You know, there's stages, right? So there's a discipline. And so me and my wife was talking about this earlier. We was talking about discipline. And so I said, well, babe, there's a couple of principles to discipline. Number one, discipline is not an option. And you know what's amazing? We walk around every day like discipline is an option. And you reaping the results of it. Right? Yeah, you got to get to a point where your revelation is discipline is not optional. Because it really isn't. It's something in us that makes us think it is. And we'll get into this in a second. And then you have to be married to discipline. So now, I married my wife. You know what I did? I committed to her. We don't have a freelance relationship. See, before I married to her, even, you know, for the first 10 months, it's kind of like freelance. Like, I spend time with you, or at a time when it looked like it was getting a little bit too close to, we didn't have sex till we got married. So when it looks like it was getting close, we was going to cross the line, I fasted for 2 weeks. Well, I ran out of the house that day because it ain't like I didn't love her, so it ain't like juices wasn't flowing, you know what I mean? But, right? You know, I mean, you just stir it up. You're feeling good. You know, you with somebody you care about, you know, on the inside. You know, you feel like, you know, you're all giddy, right? You know, and so you want to kiss, you want to hug, you want to do different things like that. That's just natural. God designed us that way, right? Yeah, but I was like, whoa, yeah. Break out. Babe, I got to go. I ain't even like give her the right send off. Like, got to go, then called her up and said, nah. I said, well, why don't we take a little break? You know, because I didn't want to get us, like, this was precious to me and I didn't want to blow it. Right? But I really was starting a level of commitment. Now I'm committed to us having a great foundation because I want us to spend the rest of our life like being the best of friends, which we are now. We challenge each other, but we the best of friends. This is my best friend right here. So I was like, but I was committed. You know what I was? I was responsible and accountable now. I mean, I'm just not doing what I want to do. Yo, girl, you rolling with me. Where was you are? Where I was at? No, what was you doing? What I was doing. Where you been? Where I came from. Nah, I just was like wondering. Yeah, well, you don't need to wonder. You just need to flow with me, girl. You just tell me what you know. No, that's not accountable and responsible. She know where I'm at. She know where I'm going. She know what I'm doing. We roll together. I'm mindful. Like, we worked out today, and so we went over a specific workout, you know. So I was telling her, I said, now, we did this for this. And I said, what it is, I said, I've been studying you. So I study what you need. And as I study what you need, I customize what I gave you for what you needed, right? I said, so there's things that you're strong at, but there's weaknesses that you might not even recognize, and your body flows a certain way. Your posture shifts and stuff like that. I said, so what I gave you will adjust all that. I spend that time. But how did I know that? She didn't tell me. She didn't even know. Because I'm studying her. You see, I'm paying attention. Look, guess what? I'm responsible. I'm accountable. She's not an accessory. Listen, I saw this watch on my way out the house, and I put it on. The watch ain't say, yo, dude, come back here. Come back. Whoa, where you going? Put me on, bro. No. The watch don't tell me nothing. It's an accessory. If when I come in the house and the watch go, where was you at? Where I came from. Where you going? Where I'm going. See, this is an accessory. My wife's not an accessory. She's essential. I'm talking about the word. I'm talking about discipline. Discipline is essential. It's not an accessory. I'll let you know when I need you. What are we doing? No. See, our discipline in the word, this is essential. It's not an accessory. And the challenge is, we've been treating this like it's an accessory. Yeah, I read today. So you get in the house, you know, you open your Bible. Yo, dude. Yo, what's up? I'm going to do you a favor. I'm going to read you today. Yeah, I'm going to look out for you. I know you've been sitting here. Yeah, I'm going to spend some time with you today. Then when I finish, you good? Yeah. You need to look out for me. It wasn't for me doing you a favor. You'd have just been sitting there all day. You're lucky I read you. Is that how it is? That's like me. You know, we just kiss each other before we leave and come back. I kiss you and go, you good? You're lucky I kissed you today. You should be happy. Look, I should see the look on her face. Now, she's never done this, but the look looked like, boy, I smack you. That's how it looked like. Oh, if that's how, I wish you would say that to me. Oh, well, that's what I would be thinking. If she's like, you're lucky I kissed you today. See, a discipline. It's a discipline. We're committing ourselves to the word. Hebrews 12. Verse 11. It says, no chastening for the present time seems to be joyous. It says, but grievous. It says, nevertheless, after it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. So what it's saying is the chastisement or the buffeting of your body or the discipline it takes to stay in the word right now, it doesn't seem joyous on the front end. Oh, but what it yields is some peaceable fruit, some good fruit. So that's the thing is, on the front end, it's going to cost you something. Now, the other thing is, the other thing to really interpret or process this word is to be born of the spirit of the word, and the word, born of the spirit and of the word. So John chapter, wow, that's a whole lot. Let's go to 1 Peter 1 first. Let's do it like this. 1 Peter 1, I'm paying attention, guys, back there. So 1 Peter 1, 23. It says, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible seed. It says, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible. Look, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth together. Verse 22 says, seeing ye have purified your souls and obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that you love one another with a pure heart fervently. Then after the colon, it says, being born again, not of corruptible seed. See, so the seed in you is not something that breaks down, but incorruptible. It says, but of incorruptible by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. This is what changes you right here, right? To be born of the Spirit and the Word. And of course, John chapter 1, 1 through 12, read it through yourself. But even when Nicodemus was talking to Jesus, he says, oh, marvel not, but you must be born again. He said, born again? I'm going to go back into my mother's womb? He says, man, except you're born of the water and of the Spirit, you can't even see or enter into the kingdom of God. It's impossible for you to process how to navigate through the kingdom of God unless you're submerged in the Spirit. And so a lot of times, if you don't submerge yourself in the things of God, you're looking through this word like it's hieroglyphics, like it's some type of foreign language. What this talking about? Yeah, so you have to submerge yourself to understand it. So number four is remember we talked about the history, the harmony, and the humility. So you have to have an attitude of humility anytime you open this Bible. There's something you don't know. Every day you're trying to find out what you don't know, not prove what you do. People spend their whole days reading the Bible trying to prove it's not authentic. Really? That's how you start? Why don't you just read it? And then if it's something you have a question, then maybe get the question answered. But why would you? That's crazy. Like, why would you open up? But you don't do that when you Facebook, the little ticker at the bottom, ESPN. You don't go in there and be looking at it. You go by everything they tell you. right? Whatever they tell you, you're going with. But now with the Bible, now we're going to question it first and foremost. So, see, this is the thing. You have to have humility because the key to spiritual insight is humility. Humility is the key to spiritual insight. You really want to go beyond the natural way of processing things. And if remember we talked about fighting the sea? The key to spiritual insight is humility. Pride and arrogance is the key to spiritual blindness. The key to spiritual insight is humility. Pride and arrogance is the key to spiritual blindness. Most people walk, you know what's so dangerous about being a blind rider? You think you see. But if you knew you was being deceived, why would they call it deception? Right? Like, if every time we've been deceived, all of us in this room, right, nobody could tell you've been deceived. And then even when you realize you've been deceived, you try to figure out a way to justify almost because you're still in pride, right? Well, I didn't really get deceived. Well, I didn't mess up. You know, if it wasn't for what they possibly could have did, I wouldn't even have been in that situation. So really, did I really, really mess up? Really? It's relative. It's all how you look at it. We had a conversation. We was talking about just the reality of stuff, like the reality of this is what it is. So you counsel somebody and they go, well, you know, I know it might have looked like this. Okay, then that's what it is. No. That's just how it looked. No, that's what it is, right? You're looking at you're embracing the truth because that's how you're free. You're free embracing the truth, right? So here, that humility is Philippians 2. It says, esteem others better than yourself. Esteem others better than yourself. So I'm esteeming these men of God when I look through this word as since they were set apart, used by God to write this word, I'm assuming they know more than me. Like even me, my wife would tell you this, as I grew in ministry, sometimes the pastor would teach some things, and I was like, I don't even understand that. The first thing I would say is, Lord, take me to that level of understanding. I wouldn't go, since I don't understand it, it ain't true. First thing I would say is, Lord, take me to that understanding. Now look, there was humility going in. Sometimes if it was off, the Lord would say, well, no, I can't take you that understanding because I don't even understand what he's talking about. Can't take you there, but I'll explain and then I'll use you like Nathan to share some things where the person will realize that okay, that's slightly off. But most of the time, I'm going to say 90% of the time as I was growing, when I asked to go to that level of understanding, I saw something different. See, because I came in with humility. I wasn't going, well, no, that don't make sense to me. Well, I don't understand it. Whoa. Could it be that the person has set themselves apart to hear and be more acute, more keen in processing what God says? Is that possible? Okay, well, let me ask you this. Okay, let's deal with some reality here, right, babe? Okay, let me ask you this. Could it be that they're more disciplined? Could it be? Well, since discipline has been an option, she will tell you, in our house, discipline ain't an option. Not because we're better than nobody. Sister Jackie, you know why discipline ain't an option? Because we ain't better than nobody. We need it. If we was better than everybody, we would think we wouldn't need discipline, right? So we ain't got discipline. Come on, babe. We pastors. What? We know all the insight and the revelation. We with God all the time. God close to us. He selected us to lead his people. So we ain't got to discipline ourselves like them peasants. Right? That's when people take sound bites. Somebody could take that and be like, look, he called the people at his church peasants. You know, then y'all get it and be like, man, pastor said that, man. Didn't even hear the whole context, right? Took it out of context. But the whole point is that there's discipline is not an option. So what you're saying is, if somebody has a level of discipline, you're saying, Lord, take me to that level. Because they're seeing something that I'm not seeing. Then that's what you want to have humility. So when I open this Bible, I know they was more disciplined than me. They ain't have some of the technology and the temptations that I have in 2016. They weren't watching no games. Or, you know, they had to go to the Coliseums and stuff like that, right? You know, yeah, whereas it was a whole nother flow. So I'm take me to that level. Show me that, Holy Spirit. Show me how that was written. What were they thinking? What was going on? Man, why did he write it like that? Why did he use that example? And the Lord will show you, you'd be walking with the person that wrote it. Seriously? I said, I never thought about that. That's sweet. Yeah, yeah. I got it now. I see what you're saying. Good looking out for me, man. See, because I want to understand. Seek first to understand, not try to be understood. Right, so there's a humility there. I wanted to give you something else here. And Acts 20:19, it says, serving the Lord with all humility of mind and with tears and temptations which befell me by the lying in wait of the Jews. So Paul saying, he says, look, I serving the Lord with all humility. I served him with all humility. I mean, I wasn't all into myself. I'm trying to find out what I don't know every day. Look, I'm not doing something and trying to create a barrier, sweetheart, around me where can't touch this. Doom, 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 doom. Like so I'm doing something that I know is not pleasing to God. And then what I do is I create a barrier where can't touch this. So you can't bring it up. You bring it up, I'm going to snap at you. Or I had a family member, you know who I'm talking about. I didn't say no names, but only me and you know this particular conversation I'm about to say. It was like, no, we're not going to talk about that right now. It was the word. Well, no, we ain't talking about that. Why? Why aren't we talking about it? Let us reason together is what the scripture says, right? In Isaiah, God said, let us reason together, Isaiah 1:18. Let's reason together. Let's talk about it. No, we ain't talking about that. No, this my baby. I'm holding on to this. You know, I've been smoking my stogies for a long time, and that is not up for discussion. Really? See, there's an arrogance there, isn't it? There's an arrogance there, isn't it? Can I get an amen? Yeah, amen. Hallelujah, Pastor. You right, Pastor. Amen. Preach, man. Preach. All right, so I just cheer myself on since y'all don't look like y'all was all excited about what I just said, so it's cool. It's cool. It's cool. So the scripture says, be clothed with humility in 1 Peter 5. But look at James 1. I'm paying attention, even though y'all might have been flashing signs. I'm paying attention. I got you. I got y'all. I just got to teach this today. So, you know, that's why we got that cushion. All right. James chapter 1. Right. Verse 21, the second part of this, where it says, wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness. Look, receive with meekness. Look, receive with meekness. Look, the engrafted word, which is able to save your souls. Now, you know when they engraft something, you know, when people have skin grafts and stuff like that, they sew that skin in. Where it eventually, because your skin processes things a certain way, where it starts to blend in with your natural skin. We'll probably get into this because we're talking about the word. But when they do with trees, what they do is they'll cut out a piece of the tree. And they'll cut a shape in the little bitty tree that they're trying to make a part of it. They'll insert it into a tree. So it's a little bitty branch. They'll insert it into a tree and they'll tie up that little branch connected to the tree and just let it sit for a while, some days, and keep feeding that thing. You know, after a while, it'll start to engraft until a point it becomes one. So it's saying receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your souls. So it's saying spend enough time attaching, connected to the word to a point where if you are John 15, let's go to John 15. I heard another audible. This is a play call in from the Holy Spirit. He's called audible. We supposed to run that out pattern, but he said, nah. These dudes looking for the out pattern, man. We're going to run that draw play on them. Yeah. For a touchdown. We about to run that draw. And that is just, you know, I John. John 15, 7. Ray. Hey. Hut, hut. See, I like football too. Football season coming, so I'm trying to get myself ready. Yeah, I know that was actually really my favorite sport. All right, so John 15, verse 7, it says, if you abide in me, remain. And look, and my words remain or abide in you, you can ask what you will and it shall be done unto you. So look, I receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save my soul, right? And so what happens is I'm so connected that that word is cut in me. Because the word is quick, sharper than a two-edged sword, right? It's sharper than, so rightly divided asunder the thoughts and intents of the heart. That's Hebrews 4:12. So that word comes in and cuts right out the pride and arrogancy. And so I keep it, the word if I hit my heart that I might not sin against thee. I keep that word in my heart so long where now it starts to abide. I'm abiding in the word and the word's abiding in me. So when I open my mouth, what comes out? Faith-filled words. Matthew 12. Let's go to Matthew 12 real quick. Matthew 12. 33. Ready? <hey! laughs> All right, so we got verse 33. It says, look. Oh, this is so good. We're talking about trees and stuff like that. It says, either make the tree good and the fruit good, or else make the tree corrupt and the fruit corrupt. For the tree is known by what? His fruit. It says, O generation viper, how can ye being evil speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speak. For a good man out of the good treasure, what he's put in his heart, good treasure of his heart bringeth forth good things, and the evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. But I say unto you that every word that men shall speak, they shall give an account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. So what it's saying is, if I hit my heart, John 15, we read to verse 7, but if you go back up to verse 3, it says, you're cleansed through the word. So I'm filled up with the word, right, babe? And that word is so filled up in me, when I'm squeezed, what comes out? The word. Now the scripture says in Romans 10, it says what? It says, faith comes by hearing and understanding. Faith comes by understanding. So the more I understand, the more faith I have, right? The more I understand, the more what? The more faith I have, right? You're going to be teaching on that, right? Yeah. All right, so on 9:15 on Sunday, right? Living faith. So what happens? Understanding, faith comes by understanding, or faith comes by hearing, which means understanding, and that comes by what? The word. Romans 10:17. So the more word I get, the more understanding I got, and that's the more faith I'm going to have. So if I get more word in me and I'm squeezed, faith-filled words come out. And the Bible says you're snared by the words of your mouth, held captive by the words of your mouth. So if I speak something that's in line with God's word, I can have whatsoever I say. If my words abide in you, if you abide in me, my words abide in you, you can ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. I don't understand. We're in the same church. We getting the same word. How come that's manifested in their life? Oh, one's speaking faith-filled words and one's speaking idle words. Oh, you don't believe me? Let's go to Hebrews 4 and then we'll end here. We were talking about this at the gym this morning, how sometimes you learn stuff, and I was sharing with the guys how, you know, one of our board members is an attorney, and, you know, every year she has to keep her, I guess it's her license, but she has to keep it up. You know, she has to take courses so she know her stuff. It's not like you got a license and you got it forever. You got to keep that thing up to date. Or there's the people that sell real estate, or what's the other thing, insurance. Yeah, they gotta take courses to keep their certification up to date. So you gotta keep you got to be ever ready. Kelly was working out with us, and he was saying for what he does, the drug testing, says every year he got to take courses to keep his certification up to date. Otherwise, you ain't testing nobody no drugs. They're like, I mean, you don't even know what we're doing now. You don't even know what we're testing. Right, so it's the same thing. I was saying how as Christians, we don't realize we got to keep ourselves up to date. We got to have a refresher. So some people are like, yeah, I know that scripture already. Do you? Oh, so you don't have to go back over it because you read that scripture before. So you know, here you'll see here certain things. We always go over faith. There's going to be a teaching on faith every year. So you'll be looking for it. Actually, we've gone over understanding the word before. It ain't going, this time it won't be like any other time before, but I guarantee you we've gone over it. Why? Because we got to stay up to date. And what I realize is because I study men of God, there's a lot of men of God, and you know, I don't do church comparison, so I'm not saying it from that angle, but I'm saying it's a lot of people that, because they're well-equipped in the word, they're not teaching the fundamentals. Not because they're evil or nothing like that. They're just, you know something, and this stuff that I know, if we were talking about the workouts, I was working the kids out last week, and I was walking them through different stages of how to get that slow fake explode to the goal. But we walked through different stages, touch the floor, shoot. Then we step back, touch the floor, shoot. Then I threw them passes, catch, shoot, catch, shoot, catch, shoot. I said, don't think, just catch, shoot, catch, shoot. Then we walked over to the side. I said, now what I want you to do is catch, same position. I kept showing them the same position. Catch in the triple threat position. I said, now I want you to slow fake and explode quick. And so the kids was going like this. I said, the person got to go for the fake. I said, so you got to make it look like you're going to shoot. I said, so I told you before, have your hands ready. When you get the ball, you have your hands ready and it looks like you're going to take the shot. I said, so bend your knees, the ball go up. Bend your knees, it looks like you're going to take the shot, and now you're ready to move. And man, you should watch them young boys. Boy, they was working that thing out. I had little guys. He was working that thing out. But what? I was telling them, I said, man, some stuff, I be forgetting. I had all the one-on-one moves. I was the one-on-one master. If I got the ball, I knew how to set you up to score every time. Yeah, I had studied the Dr. J drills, all the different drills and stuff like that. And I said, man, this stuff that you take for granted. I'm still talking about the work. You got all this stuff that you can take for granted. So that's why we're going over the word again. So what did I say? Hebrews 4? Or is it 6? Promise. So it's got to be in 4 then. 4:2. Yeah, thank you, sweetheart. All right. It says, for unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them. The word, the good news. So look, we all sat in the service and it was preached unto both of us. But look at this. It says, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. So you had two people that got the word, but one person that profited, the other person that didn't. One person mixed their word with faith. They have faith in that word, and the other person it's just words. They have mental assent. They agreed with the word, but they didn't apply any faith to the word. So you can sit in the same church, be getting the same word. This scripture says it didn't profit them, but it profited us. You see what I'm saying? So it ain't just, yeah, I heard that great sermon. Oh, it's powerful today. No, guess what? There's always a homework assignment. Application. That's our homework assignment. Apply it. All right, so that's enough for today. Let's talk to the people online. And where did I end? And anybody, anything stood out? Were you challenged in a particular area? Made you think about some things?
Thanks for tuning in to today's broadcast. To view videos or make donations, feel free to access our website at www.heirscc.org. Remember, at Heirs, we believe we're just what you prayed for.